Tonight, thank you for your faithful servants. Thank you for the soul winners. Thank you for everything you've been doing. Jesus' name. We pray you wake up everyone tonight. We pray that the spirit that conquers, you grant to everyone tonight in Jesus' name. Take discouragement away. Take the fainting fits away. And Lord, we pray the zeal to serve the Lord, you grant to everyone. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Somebody give me another good amen. We're looking at 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. I'm reading from verse 1. And they have told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and withal how he had slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. In verse 3, and when he saw that, when Elijah heard and saw that, he arose and he went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. Tonight we're looking at the life of Elijah, and we're looking at our lives. We're looking at the lives of the servants of God, the saints of God, members of the church, ministers of the gospel. As we look at Elijah, I'm sure we have all heard of Elijah. Elijah has been described as a man of like passions as we are, subject to like passions like we are. He was a prophet who served the Lord, who labored for the Lord faithfully. He was like Enoch in that he was righteous, he was holy. He was eventually taken to heaven without going through the gates of sickness and death. As you look at Elijah's life, as you look at his labors, they were spectacular and they were exemplary. He was a sage person who knew he was saved to serve. He lived and he moved and he walked by the word of the Lord. He always acted on the basis of the word of God. He was surrounded by corrupters and by compromisers, yet he was courageous for the Lord and committed to God and his word, speaking to God. See what he said in the previous chapter, that is chapter 18 and verse 36. In verse 36 it says, and it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant. Listen to this. And that I have done, tell me, all these things at thy word. You look at the life of Elijah, and he said, everything I said, everything I did, everything I prophesied, everywhere I went, everywhere I labored, I have done all these things according to thy word. He repaired the altar of the Lord. He brought fire down from heaven. He turned the hearts of the people back to the Lord again. He dealt with false prophets in the land and got rid of all those prophets of Baal. And he said, I wasn't doing that for any personal reason. I looked at the word of God and I saw what the Lord had commanded, and I've done all these things at thy word, according to thy word. But however, today we're looking at an occasion in his life. Thank God, just an occasion in his life. It wasn't a long thing, and it wasn't a perennial thing. It wasn't an annual thing. It wasn't like this every year. It wasn't like this every time. But just on this occasion, he was discouraged. On this occasion, he fainted in his spirit. He fainted in his mind. But thank God, the Lord quickly came to his rescue. and strengthened him, like he's going to strengthen you tonight. And he recommissioned him, he'll recommission you tonight. He emboldened him and he got him ready for a glorious rapture. As you look at this chapter, you'll see the discouragement, and you see the fainting, and you see what he began to tell the Lord in his prayer. We're looking at it from verse 4 now of 1 Kings chapter 19. But he himself went to this journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might tell me, that he might tell me out loud, that he might die. He didn't know that God was preparing him for a glorious scene. You know, sometimes we're blind to the future. We're blind to what the Lord is preparing for us. He's preparing something great for you. Something extraordinary for you. But you know, if you're not careful, at the time of slight discouragement, at the time of fainting, we'll say, I don't have any future. I don't want to think about any other thing now. All I want to think about is die. Thank God, he does not answer your negative prayer. And every negative thing you have said about yourself, in the time of discouragement, in the time of fainting, the Lord wiped everything away. Because his will for your life will take the preeminence. And his word for your life will still be fulfilled in Jesus' name. He said, he requested for himself that he might die. And he said, it is enough. Now, O Lord, take away my life. For I am not better than my fathers. I didn't know any of his fathers that brought fire from heaven. He was better than them. I didn't know any of his fathers that brought a revival back to the land. He was better than his fathers. I didn't know any of his fathers that turned the whole of the hearts of the nation and turned them to God. But you know, at the time of discouragement, we say things that are meaningless and things that are not true. And thank God, God is a loving God. God is a merciful God. He doesn't count that against us. He just knows that that's not you talking, that's discouragement talking. I said, that's not you talking, that's a fainting heart talking. And it will reverse every negative thing in Jesus' name. And he said, as he lay down and slept under a juniper tree, behold then, who came? An angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat, you won't die yet. Arise and eat. It's not the time to pack up and go home and say, I can't do anything again. You're going to do more than you ever did in your life, in your ministry before. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and the cruse of water at his side. Angel came to serve him. You remember his story in chapter 17. The birds came to serve him. But now, beyond a bird, beyond any kind of sparrow or whatever, now an angel came and he saw the cake and the cruse of water. And he did eat and drink and laid him down again. Laid him down again. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time. The angel will keep coming until you wake up. The revival will keep coming until you wake up. And the power of the Lord and the energy from above will be pumped into you until you rise up and do what the Lord has appointed, anointed you for you to do. You will do it in Jesus' name. Nobody will take your place. Nobody will take your crown. Everything you did that you will do, even though you are discouraged, even though you are fainting, even though you think I cannot, you can. And you will. And you must in Jesus' name. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink and went in the strength of that meat, tell me, 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. And it came to pass unto, and he came hither unto a cave, and he lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him. The word of the Lord will say, come to you. He will not pack you up. He will not abandon you. He will not say, okay, you are discouraged, you have gone, okay, go your way. He has something for you. He cannot just release you like that. You will not go your way, you will go the way of the Lord. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said unto him, what doest thou here, Elijah? Prophet, my servant, what doest thou here? The one that just got rid of all those hundreds of false prophets and prophets of Baal. What are you doing here? The one that single-handedly aroused the whole nation and brought the whole nation back to the Lord. What are you doing here? Prophet of fire and the fervent spiritual prophet and preacher of the word of God, bringing the whole nation back to the Lord. What doest thou here, Elijah? You know, sometimes as you are maybe back at home and other people are going for evangelism, other people are going for soul winning, other people are desperate trials, and then you have been thinking of something negative. Look at my family, look at my children, look at my wife, look at my husband, look at my job, look at this and look at that, and you see you are thinking about not knowing God has a better plan you can ever think about. All those children, leave them in the hands of God, you'll see the plan of God very soon. That wife, that husband, leave them in the hands of God, you'll see the plan of God for them very soon. And that business and that work you are thinking about this, leave that in the hands of God. You're going to see something beyond your prayer. The Lord was surprised with a miracle. And so he had been thinking about a negative thing. That's why he just coiled up and stayed in that corner. Look at me, look at me. And the Lord said, Elijah, there's nobody like you in the nation. Elijah, there's nobody that has your future, the future I have for you, apart from Enoch, who for many years now had gone to heaven and is still there. I have a similar plan for you. You are a special person in the sight of the Lord. And here you are, and you're like an orphan. You're like you have nobody. You're like helpless. You're like hopeless. And the Lord is saying, what are you doing here? And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel are forsaking thy covenant, and they have thrown down thine altars, and they have slain thy prophets, and with the sword, and I, even I only, I'm the only holy one, even I only, I'm the only sanctified one, I only, I'm the only one holding by sound doctrine, I only, I'm the only one earnestly contending for the faith once delivered unto the saints. How about those, pastors there, I don't know about them. How about the group pastors, I don't know about them. How about those overseers, I don't know about them. I am the only one. You know, sometimes when you get discouraged, you become so narrow-minded, and you think you are the only one, but thank God you are not the only one. I am like you are like I am, and we're like each other, and we have the Spirit of God within us, and we're going to run the race together in Jesus' name. Are you the only one? I said, are you the only one? He said, I only am left, and they seek my life. Elijah, correct your language. They seek my life. It's only Jezebel. It's not they. She. Only one person. You know, we magnify our hill. We make it a mountain. It's like the whole world is after me. Everybody is again. No. Just one persecutor. No. Just one Jezebel. No. Just somebody that wasn't thinking right. Only one person that didn't know the value of this great man of God. The whole nation, they turned to the Lord and they said, praise the Lord. They said, the Lord is God. The Lord is God. But you know, when we're discouraged, it's like everybody is against me. No, everybody is not against you. In a church of 100, maybe there are one or two people there that, you know, something came upon them and they tried to fight a battle they have lost already. And then you said, the whole church, no, we love you. I said, we love you. We accept you. We appreciate you. And we're praying for you. And this work will prosper in your hands in Jesus' name. Remember, there may be one Jezebel that is against you, but there are more than 100, 1,000, 1 million other people in the land that are praying for you. We're praying for you. You will not fail. You will not succumb. You'll not yield to the devil in Jesus' name. And he said, go forth, verse 11, and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by. and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and break in pieces the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after that, after the earthquake, a fire, and the Lord was not in the fire. And after that, after the fire, a still small voice. And it was so. When Elijah heard that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entry of the gate, and behold, there came a voice unto him and said, "What doest thou here, Elijah? What doest thou here, Elijah?" I want you to look at your family and look at your position in your family. I want you to look at your family. Look at how God has selected you out of your family. Look at your family. Look at the extended family. And look at the anointing he has placed upon you. And the acceptance that he has for you. And the special ministry that he has for you that nobody else in your extended family has. He has selected you. He has chosen you. He has given you something special and something extraordinary that even all the other people are saying, "How did our brother come to this? How did our sister come to this? How is he that just, you know, like a joke, now she's doing something that we are jealous of?" And that's the case of Elijah here. Elijah had a special calling, a special anointing, and a special authority, and a special power, and a special communication, interaction with heaven. And yet, look at Elijah that heaven knows, he didn't know himself. Elijah that the Almighty God knew, he didn't know himself. You know, when you don't know yourself, you are discouraged, you are despondent, you are in despair. It's like depression has come. It's like, what am I doing here? It's like, am I saved? Am I a child of God? If I'm a child of God, why is this happening? Why is this happening? Am I in good tune with the Lord? Am I acceptable by the Lord? If I'm acceptable to the Lord, why is this woman? Everybody appreciates what we're doing. Everybody appreciates this, the revival that is taking place. And now Jezebel is sending a message to me and he says, "By this time tomorrow, I am going to deal with you." All of a sudden, the man forgot his position. I pray you'll not forget your position. He forgot his authority. A man that prayed and fire came down from heaven, he forgot all about that. You'll not forget what God has used you to do, what God has used you to bring into the church, into the ministry. And so now he said, look at verse 14, when it says, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" And he said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel are forsaking thy covenant and thrown down thy altars and slain thy prophets with the edge of the sword." And I, you saying that again, you know, sometimes some people, once you are discouraged, the one sentence you preach at the beginning of the discouragement, that's how you'll be praying for another week. That's how you'll be praying for another month. That's how you'll be praying. If God does not jolt you and remove that word from your mouth, you'll be saying that dumb thing that is not true. I pray that your prayer will change tonight. The prayer of discouragement and the prayer of despondency and the prayer of fainting and the prayer of, "I'm the only one, nobody loves me, nobody wants to see the work prosper, I'm laboring, I'm doing this, I'm doing this. Who are the other people? Who are the soul winners? Who are this? Who are that? They say there's revival, but I can't see revival in our area. I can see the revival in your area." I said, "I can see." I pray that the Lord will open your eyes tonight in Jesus' name. And he said, "They've thrown down your altars. They have slain your prophets with the edge of the sword. And I only am left. And they seek to stand, and they seek my life." They. How many of them? I said, how many of them? Only one person. Elijah. Change your life. Don't exaggerate. Don't exaggerate. You know, there's a problem in the land. They're killing all the Christians. That's not true. That's not true. We cannot do anything here. Anybody that goes out there and makes a money cry, they kill everybody. They destroy everybody. They run everybody away. Nobody wants a church. Nobody wants Christ. It's not true. You know you are exaggerating. And you know Elijah here, this is exaggeration. It says, "And the sea my life." And the Lord said unto him, the Lord will speak to you tonight. And the Lord said unto him, go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Azael, the king over Syria. He gave him greater authority. Greater authority coming upon your life. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shall thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah, shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And then it says, and it shall come to pass, to him that escapeth the sword of Azael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. Verse 18. Now, yet I have let me, tell me. Yet I have let me, tell me out loud. Elijah did not see any of these 7,000 people ready to serve the Lord. The people that have not gone after Baal, Elijah did not see them. You know, sometimes when you are discouraged, you don't see the believers in the congregation. Everybody is a backslider. Everybody is compromising. Everybody is, gone down. Nobody believes holiness like we do anymore. Nobody believes sanctification like we used to do anymore. That's not true, my brother. You're talking out of discouragement. There are people that are taking their stand. There are people that are standing for the Lord. There are people who have the grace of God in their lives. Thank God you are one of them. I say, thank God you are one of them. Am I talking to somebody there tonight? Are you still saved? Why did they say there's nobody saved anymore? Are you still sanctified? Why did they say there's no sanctified people anymore? Are you still holy? I can't hear you. Are people? Of course, yes. And so God said, yet have I left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal, every mouth which has not kissed him. So he departed thence. Fire came back. Power came back. Zeal came back. Commitment came back. Consecration came back. Obedience of the Lord came back. Tonight I'm talking to you on supernatural strength for fainting members and ministers. Supernatural strength for fainting members and ministers. You'll not faint anymore. I said you'll not faint anymore. Supernatural strength and courage will come to you tonight. Supernatural strength for fainting members and ministers. There are three things we're looking at. Number one, the faithfulness of foundation ministers. The faithfulness of foundation ministers at the foundation. When Elijah started, come and see faithfulness, come and see faith, and come and see commitment, and come and see consecration. When Elijah started at the foundation, the faithfulness of foundation ministers. Point number two, the forgetfulness of fainting members. We faint when we forget. We forget our calling, we faint. We forget our commission, we faint. We forget our past successes, and we faint. We forget the high mountain the Lord has taken us to, and we faint. We forget our privileges divine, and we faint. We forget all the good things and the great things the Lord has done through us, and then we faint. The forgetfulness of fainting members. Number three now, the fruitfulness of a focused ministry. You will yet be fruitful. More fruitful than you have ever been. And God is going to use you to raise up the standard, even in the land, in Jesus' name. The fruitfulness of a focused ministry. Tell me number one there. The faithfulness of foundation ministers. Let's look at Elijah at the foundation. When he began the ministry, it just came out in chapter 17, 1 Kings chapter 17 from verse 1. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain this year. But tell me out loud, according to my word. This man had faith in God. This man was faithful to God. This man was very sure about his calling. This man was very sure about his connection with heaven. At the foundation, when he began the ministry, at the foundation, when he showed up for the first time in public ministry, he came to Ahab. He said, "Ahab, I stand before God. I'm coming from the presence of the Lord. I have covenant with the Lord. I have commission from the Lord. And I'm going to declare the word to you. And my word will affect the whole nation." It says, according to my word, there shall not be rain nor dew. And then it says in verse 2, "And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee hence, and turn thee his watch, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith that is before Jordan. And it came to pass that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I shall and have commanded the ravens to feed thee there." No argument. The Lord said, "Famine is coming. There'll be no rain. There'll be no dew according to your word. Now go to the brook Cherith, and as you stay there, think about that. No shelter there. Think about that. No house there. Think about that. There was nothing, the security fence there. But just stay there. All the wild animals were there, but he knew the animals could not touch him. Wild animals will not touch you. Evil hands will not touch you." That was the foundation of Elijah. And then he went there. So he went and he did according to the word of the Lord. He went and he did according to the word of the Lord. You see, when you are at the foundation, when you first gave your life to the Lord, you did according to the word of the Lord. When you first became a minister, a preacher, a soul winner, whatever you had from the word of God, at that foundation level, you did according to the word of the Lord. And there was nobody with him. He was alone, all alone by himself. He wasn't looking at, is the other person practicing it? Is the other person obeying? Is the other person going along with me? A lone ranger. He went as the Lord had called him. He said, "I don't need the encouragement of anybody. I don't need the support of anybody. What the Lord had said, that I will do." That was at the beginning. And I pray that God will bring us back to the beginning, Jesus' name. Where you're not like a parasite, you're not leaning on somebody, you're not seeing any other person doing it, any other person obeying, but you can obey by yourself. It says in that verse 5, it says, "So he went and he did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook." The Lord will feed you. The Lord will satisfy you. And whatever the needs are in your life, the Lord will meet all those needs in Jesus' name. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. The brook dried up. He didn't complain. He didn't say, "God, what am I going to do now? What am I going to eat now? You brought me over here and then everything has dried up now." He was waiting for God. You know, that's what we did at the beginning. We just waited on God. We waited until God will speak. We are not harassed. We are not disturbed. We are not kind of having worry and anxiety. We didn't say what will happen next, what will happen next. At the time, we first believed. We just believed the Lord implicitly. That was the foundation at that time. When we were saying to go and do some missionary work, we didn't have any members there. And there was no member there. And we didn't say, "Who will support us? Who will give us accommodation? Who is going to evangelize with us?" We went there and the work of the Lord prospered in our hands. When we were to go for evangelism in the bus, on the train, anywhere, as foundation members and ministers in the church, we stood up in the bus and we declared the word of God without fear, without favor. Those days will come back again. Money cry will come back again. And street preaching will come back again. Boss evangelism will come back again. And preaching everywhere, everywhere. There was no shame. And there was no hiding your face. You're not okay. "I saw that person there. I saw that person there. And when I saw them, then I cringed. I couldn't talk anymore." Wherever we saw, we just stood up and we said, "Here is the gospel today." And then they were looking at us. And then the people, you had tracts in your hand. And then you just gave them. They could not reject or refuse the tract you were given. those days will come back again. At the foundation level, like Elijah, that's how we did it. We didn't mind whatever anybody said, whatever anybody did, however they look, their posture, whatever. We knew that the Lord has sent us and the Lord was backing us up, and that God has not changed. If anything has changed, it's you who have changed. But no, you're going to come back to where you were in Jesus' name. And then look at this. And the word in verse 8, and the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Arise, get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded, tell me, I've commanded Emilonia, I've commanded Bilonia, I've commanded a rich man, I commanded IFL, I commanded VIP, who? A widow woman to sustain thee. A widow woman to sustain thee. How are we going to build the church? There's no Bilonia in the church. How are we going to build the church? There's no Bilonia here. How are we going to build the church? All these people that are bags, that money bags, they are not here. The widows will build the church. The converts were built in the church. Those who are just coming, they are getting converted, and the Lord is turning their lives, and the riches and resources of the Gentiles will flow to the church in Jesus' name. And so Elijah again did not worry. Elijah did not ask any question. Elijah did not worry about how will this happen, how will this happen. You know the story. And as he came to the gate, he saw the woman, and he said, that's the woman. You recognize your converts. You recognize your disciples. And when you speak, they will listen to you in Jesus' name. He said, can you bring me some water there? And while the woman was going, he said, and then when you are coming back, I bring a morsel of meal in your hand. And the woman said, I have nothing. That's a widow. I have nothing in my hand. I'm just cooking the last so that we cook that and we eat and we are dead. And then Elijah said, hear the word of the Lord. That cruse of oil will not fail. That barrel of meal will not fail until God brings plenty abundance into the land. And it was so. I said it was so. You see, if you don't allow discouragement in your heart, the word in your mouth will be power. The word in your mouth will be fulfilled. If you're looking at God, if you're listening to God, and you do what he has told you to do, and you say what he has told you to say, miracles will happen in Jesus' name. Look at chapter 18. I'm reading from verse 21. Chapter 18, verse 21. Elijah came unto all the people and said, Hold on here. Here he came as a revivalist. Here he came as an evangelist. He didn't have any team. Here you are now. You are chosen like an Elijah. And you are to go to that community. And you are saying, how many workers do I have? Elijah did not have any. How many supporters do I have? Elijah did not have any. And yet he was to turn the hearts of all the people unto the Lord. At the foundation. Let's come back to our foundation. The word of God will turn hearts around in your life and through your life in Jesus' name. And so he came in verse 21. Elijah came and to all the people and said, how long will ye halt between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. But eventually, you know the story. He told them, you have many prophets of Baal. Let them now take whatever they want to take. And then kill the bull. And then pray to their God. And see the God that answers by fire, he will be our God. And the people said, that's right. You said, well, look at verse 31. And Elijah took 12 stones according to the number of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. And then we come to verse 36. In verse 36, and it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, that Elijah alone. Do you know God can walk through you? I can't hear you. Even if you don't have any, and thank God you have supporters. You can't say that, you know, I have nobody, because you have a team of workers along with you. If Elijah alone can do it without any other support, with all the workers and the Spirit of Christ in the life of everyone, you will do exploits for the Lord in Jesus' name. And it came to pass at the time of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel, let it be known when. Let it be known when. When will the power of God be seen in you? When will that anointing flow out through you? When will courage come back? And then you'll do the work of God. And then you will not look back anymore. I said when. I said when. It will be so in Jesus' name. Let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that these people may know that thou art the Lord God, and thou hast turned their heart back again. Then, why are we complaining that the people are cold, the people are lukewarm, the people are dull, the people are sluggish, the people are not moving? Bring the fire down. I said, bring the fire down. Preach and bring fire. Pray and bring fire. Intercede and bring the fire. Stop complaining. The key is in your hand. The power is right there. The promise had been given unto you. He alone prayed, and then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the doors, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces and they said, the Lord, he is God. The Lord, he is God. And Elijah said unto them, take the prophets of Baal, and let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon, and slew them there. And Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, and eat, and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. That man brought revival down. As you look at Elijah at the foundation level, you will see that he had complete, entire obedience to the Lord. And you will also find that the word of the Lord in his mouth, the entirety of the word of God, was the basis of his experiences and his exploits. His experiences and exploits. You go back to the word of God, not about your feeling, not about the people, not about Jezebel, not about what anybody is saying, and you come back to the word, your experience will come back again. Exploits will come back again. Not only that, his faith and his faithfulness, his faith was based on the word of God. He wasn't thinking about, you know, who I am or who I am not, what I have or what I don't have. The word of God formed the basis of his faith and of his faithfulness, of his character and counsels, of his character and counsels. That woman said, I don't have anything, I'm just cooking the last meal and then I will die with my son. His counseling was not according to the situation in the land, according to the recession in the land, according to the famine in the land. His character, his counsel was according to the word of the Lord. His commission and his consecration at this beginning, commission and consecration, the Lord has spoken, go there, I'm going there. Come back, I'm coming back. Go to the widow, I'm going to the widow. His commission was according to the word. His consecration commitment was according to the word. His decision and his devotion. He didn't have any kind of a decision apart from the word of God. Hear what the Lord had said. And because the Lord had said what he said, I'm going to go according to the word. And then his devotion, totally devoted, totally dedicated to obeying the word of the Lord. His wisdom and his workmanship. You know, there are people, they say they are using wisdom, they abandon the work of God, the word of God. They say, I'm going to apply wisdom now. now, and actually they're applying the wisdom of the world, and that thing will not work. But you come back to the word of God. The word of God has said this. The word of God is the wisdom of God, and it is that word of God you work on. Your workmanship will depend on the word of the Lord, his service and his sacrifice. Look at his service. He said, I've done all these according to thy word. What the Lord is telling us today is this: if we're going to go back to the beginning, that is to the foundation ministry, how we started, how the great men of God in the Bible, like Moses, how they started, like Peter, how they started, like Paul, how they started, and many of them, they started like Paul the apostle. He continued, he started, he continued, he started, he continued. It is light back. There was a time of discouragement, and I pray that the fire will come to every soul back again today in Jesus' name. Your experience, check up according to the word of God. Am I saved? Am I sanctified? Am I baptized in the Holy Ghost? And your exploits according to the word of the Lord. You're not looking at, you know, my predecessor. You know, he wasn't like this. My senior is not like this. You're by yourself. The Lord has called you, and the anointing is upon your life. You're not looking at a predecessor. You're not looking at your senior. You're not looking at anybody. You're saying, I'm going to base my exploits, I'm going to base my experiences on the word of the Lord. Your faith will not be according to, you know, other people are not praying like this, other people are not expecting this, other people are not, you know, turning things over and turning things around. Your faith will be on the word of God. Your faithfulness will be on the word of God, your character and your counsel. When you're counseling people, you'll not be so sympathetic and say, well, I know the word of God says this, but you know, in this time in which we're living now, can you counsel somebody according to this word of the Lord? Well, you can say according to the word of the Lord, the power of the Lord will back that counseling. But if you use a carnal wisdom, satanic wisdom, fleshly wisdom, human wisdom, the Lord cannot back you up. Bring back your character and your counsel on the basis of the word of God. Your commission, the commission remains the same today. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Not only that, your consecration, now you lay everything upon the altar. You know, like, you know what we did originally, and we said, I've opened my mouth to the Lord, I will not go back. You bring back your vow. I said you bring back your vow. I said you bring back your vow, and you bring back your consecration. And when you do that, the Lord himself will support you in Jesus' name. Your decision and your devotion. Your decision. You're not taking your decision on the basis of, my friend, what do you think? My brother, what do you think? My sister, what do you think? You know, I want to do this. I want to take this step. I want to lay everything upon the altar. I want to run for the Lord. I want to serve the Lord. I want to dedicate my life to the evangelism and to winning all this community to the Lord. And I want to get all these workers together, train them, and we're going to reach out. We're going to touch everybody. Should I not? Oh, you're asking him. If the Lord has spoken to you, if the Lord had given you the vision, if the Lord had dropped it to your heart, the great commission, and he says that you are the man, you are the woman to get it done, the way we did it originally at the foundation, as foundation ministers, that's how you're going to do it. And you're not going to have, you know, any worldly wise man, worldly wise woman, the people who are not thinking of the wisdom of God, and they're thinking of the wisdom of the flesh and the wisdom of the devil, the wisdom that is fleshly, and the wisdom that is human, and the wisdom that is selfish. All that you brush aside, and you say you're going to walk according to the word and the wisdom of the Lord, and your service will be sacrificial. I said your service will be sacrificial, and you will walk with faith and faithfulness as in the foundation, at the foundation level. But let's look at Elijah now. Point number two, we're looking at the forgetfulness of fainting ministers. The forgetfulness of fainting ministers. You know, when we forget the past experiences. We forget how the Lord answered us by fire. We forget how we ran individually, and we're not looking back. That forgetfulness will bring fainting. We're coming to 1 Kings chapter 19, and I'm reading from verse 2. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, so they got to do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow, about this time. Now, see, look at that verse 2. It says, just Jezebel sent a messenger and said, I will make your life like one of those people that you destroyed, one of those false prophets. And Elijah now fainted in his spirit. He fainted in his mind. He became temporarily weakened. He thought of Jezebel more than he thought of Jehovah. You know, that's a problem. When you think about a man more than you think about your God. When you think about Jezebel more than you think about Jehovah. When you think about a creature more than you think about the Creator, and your mind shifts away from the Almighty, and your mind shifts away from the Maker of heaven and earth, and your mind shifts away from Calvary, and your mind shifts away from the power and the glory of the Lord, and you're thinking about this Jezebel now. Not only that, he forgot his own faith. He forgot his own fire. This is a man of fire. He can bring fire down anytime. And you'll see, when the Lord brought him back again in chapter 1 of 2 Kings, and the people said, man of God, come down. The king is calling you. He said, if I'm a man of God, what did he say? A fire come down, consume you or your 50. What happened? The fire came down. This man was a man of fire. He forgot his faith. He forgot his fire. Not only that, he forgot his position. And he forgot his power. The Lord had raised up this man that heaven will answer him like not answer anybody in the land of Israel. But he forgot all that. He forgot his own words. And he forgot his own wonders. He had told Ahab, there'll be no rain, there'll be no dew all these years according to my word. According to my word. This man knew that he had the word from heaven. He had the word that had power. He had forgotten about all that. All the wonders that God did through him. How he prayed. A simple prayer. And fire came down from heaven. And the whole of the nation said, the Lord is God. The Lord is God. He had forgotten about that. He forgot about his concern. His concern for the land. That you will turn the minds of the people back to yourself again. He forgot his courage, the courage he had when he took all those prophets of Baal and he got rid of them single-handedly. He forgot his concern. He forgot his courage. He forgot his vision. He forgot his value. The vision he had, that this nation must know the Lord. This nation must turn to the Lord. This nation must serve the Lord. And he forgot the value that heaven had placed upon him. When he forgot his stage and his stature, he forgot his stage and his stature, the standing that man had with heaven, and the stature, spiritual stature that that man had, he forgot about that. He forgot his foundation, he forgot his future. He forgot his foundation, he forgot his future. His future was to be the future to be raptured. He was not to see death. He forgot all about that. He forgot his foundation, how God started with him. You know why we faint? Because we forget. We forget, and forgetfulness will breed fainting in our lives. I want you to think back now in your life when you had the highest point of faith in your life, and when you said, I don't care whatever the problem is, I'm going to take this to the Lord, and the Lord is going to remove this mountain. Why did you forget that faith? And then the fire you used to have, the fervency you used to have, and the drive you used to have, and the zeal you used to have. Are you not the same person that will stand up single-handedly? Are you not the same person even before you got married, as a spinster, as a lady that, you know, was not even married, and you could dare anything in the service of the Lord? And when they said, now we're going to contribute all the money you had, everything, hey sister, how about paying your house rent? At the end of the month, God will provide. How about this? How about that? God will provide. This one now, I'm going to sink everything I have into it. You're forgetting your faithfulness. And it is when we forget our faith of the past, our faithfulness of the past, that's when we get into desperation. spear, and then Jezebel is threatening us, and is saying, now I'm going to deal with you, and she can do nothing. I said she can do nothing. Even Ahab, her husband, can do nothing. And Ahab and Jezebel joined together. We have the word from heaven. We have the power from heaven. We have the fire from heaven. And whatever Ahab and whatever Jezebel may stand on the way. Who is the Jezebel on your trail? Who is the Jezebel that is running you out of town? Who is the Jezebel that is trying to stop you? And you say, well, I would have done this, but look at Jezebel there. She's right there at the corner, and she's waiting for me. And what I wanted to do, I cannot. Shake that off. I said, shake that off. And confront that Jezebel. And when you stand in the strength of the Lord, in the power of the Lord, that Jezebel will clear out of the way. Our God is mighty. Jezebel is not. Our God is all powerful. Jezebel is not. Our God is supernatural. Jezebel is not. Our God is eternal, immortal. Jezebel is not. Our God is unlimited. Jezebel is not. Our God is unconquerable. And Jezebel is not. Our God is a consuming fire. I said our God is a consuming fire. Jezebel is not. Who is Jezebel but a weak worm? Who is Jezebel but withering grass? Who is Jezebel but a poor, small, minute, little creature about to be consumed? Who is making you afraid? Who is running you out of town? Who is making you to abandon the post of duty that the Lord has given you? Rise up, you're bigger than this. You're stronger than that. You have graduated from that kind of a shivering class. You are not in that class anymore. Let the fire come back. Let the power come back. Let the anointing come back. Let the authority come back. And you will serve the Lord like in the days of old, in Jesus' name. Look at Isaiah chapter 51. Isaiah chapter 51. I'm reading from verse 12. And I'm reading from verse 13. Isaiah chapter 51. We're reading from verses 12 and 13. It says in verse 12, I am he that comforteth you. Who art thou that thou shouldest be afraid of a man that shall die? Who art thou that thou shouldest be afraid of a Jezebel that will die? Of the son of man which shall be made as grass, and forgettest the Lord thy maker, that has stretched forth the heavens and laid the foundation of the earth, and has feared continually every day because of the few of the oppressor, as if he were ready to destroy. Where is the fury of the oppressor? It's all gone. I said it's all gone. We're looking at chapter 57. Isaiah chapter 57, and reading from verse 11. Isaiah chapter 57, and I'm reading from verse 11. It says, and of whom hast thou been afraid or feared, that thou hast lied, that thou hast cringed, that thou hast compromised, that thou hast fled from your post of duty, and hast not remembered me, nor laid it to heart? Have not I held my peace even of old, and thou fearest not me? We're not going to cringe anymore. Amen. Jezebel or no Jezebel, we're moving on. Amen. I said we're marching on. You will overcome in Jesus' name. Point number three now. Point number three. The fruitfulness of a focused ministry. From now on, you'll be focused. Nothing will make you afraid. Nothing will make you sit down. And nothing will intimidate you anymore in Jesus' name. Did you hear that? Amen. Now coming back to 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. I'm reading from verse 15. God has greater ministry awaiting you. Greater work waiting for you. In 1 Kings chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 15. And the Lord said unto him, go, return thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. Work is going to start again. ministry is going to start again. Jezebel was still there. God did not even mention Jezebel. Jezebel had given out the threat, and then, I'm surprised, Jezebel did not even look for Elijah. They will not touch you. They will not look for you. They're only bragging. A little storm will come, and that tree of Jezebel will fall down in Jesus' name. Go back and return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou comest, anoint Azael to be king over Syria. You are going to have authority over nations. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shall thou anoint to be king over Israel. Look at what he would have missed. Thank God he didn't kill himself. Thank God he didn't commit suicide. He was only praying the negative prayer, God, come and kill me. God will not kill you. He'll give you a new commission. You have new power, new anointing, new authority, new ministry in Jesus' name. And then he says, Elisha, the son of Shaphat of Abel Mahola, shall thou anoint to be prophet in thy room. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Azael shall Jehu slay, and him that escapeth the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. And yet, I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed down unto Baal, and every mouth that have not kissed him. So he departed, Elijah, fire has come back. Zeal has come back. Commitment has come back. Obedience has come back. You are going home, back to home today energized. You are going back home empowered. All the, you know, shivering and trembling, everything is vanishing away now in Jesus' name. So he departed thence, and he found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with a yoke of oxen before him, and he was the 12, and Elijah passed by him, and he cast the mantle on him. There are people who are going to have your mantle. The people you are going to share this vision with. The people you are going to share this power with. And when you say come, they will not reject. They'll be part of the team. A winning team. Who are going to evangelize all your communities and their city and every city in Jesus' name. And he left the oxen and he ran after Elijah. Somebody will run after you. Partners in ministry, companions in ministry, workers in ministry, and said, let me, I pray thee, kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow thee. And he said unto him, go back again, for what have I done unto thee? You'll not even be able to escort them, they'll become disciples. And he returned back from him, and he took a yoke of oxen, and he slew them, and boiled their flesh with the instruments of the oxen, and he gave to the people, and he did eat. Then he arose and went after Elijah. Now he had a companion. He arose and went after Elijah. Now you have a companion. Now he arose and went after Elijah. Now you have somebody who will pour water upon your hand. I said you have somebody who will pour water upon your hand. Now he arose and went after Elijah. Now you have somebody that will continue the work after you. And ministered unto him. And ministered unto him. And let's come to 2 Kings chapter 1. In 2 Kings chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 1. Then Moab rebelled against Israel after the death of Ahab, and Hazza fell down through a lattice in his upper chamber that was in Samaria, and was sick. And he sent messengers and said unto them, go, inquire of Beelzebub, the God of Ekron, whether I shall recover of this disease. And the angel of the Lord said unto, tell me, Elijah the Tishbite, there's still message for you to carry. Work for you still to do. Sacrifice still to demonstrate. Arise, go up to meet the messengers of the king of Samaria, and say unto them, Is it not because there is not a God in Israel that he go to inquire of Beelzebub, the God of Ekron? Now therefore, thus says the Lord, thou shalt not come down from the bed, from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shalt surely die. And Elijah departed. Has Elijah recovered? Have you recovered? I said, have you recovered? You recover in Jesus' name. Where is Jezebel? Nowhere to be found. I said, where is Jezebel? Where are your persecutors? Where are those who are threatening you? Where are the people you are afraid of? You walk over them in Jesus' name. Look at verse 5. And when the messengers turned back unto him, he said unto them, why are ye now turned back? And they said unto him, there came a man to meet us, and said unto us, go, turn again unto the king that sent you, and say unto him, thus says the Lord, is it not because there is not a God in Israel that thou sendest to inquire of Beelzebub, the God of Ekron? Therefore, thou shalt not come down from that bed on which thou art gone up, but shall surely die. My question to you is this: can you be this faithful? Elijah gave them the message, telling he's going to die. And then you now go to the king and said, how you come back so soon? Because a man met us and he told us that you are going to die. You see, we should not modify the word of God and the message of God. Even though it may appear tough, you are going to deliver that message. Verse 7, and he said unto them, what manner of man was he which came to meet you and told you these words? And he answered him, he was an airy man, and girt with a girdle of leather. He bowed his loins, and he said, it is Elijah the Tishbite. And the king said, a saint unto him, a captain of 50, and with 50, and he went up to him, and behold, he sat on top of an hill, and spake unto him, thou man of God, the king has said, come down. And Elijah answered and said to the captain of 50, tell me, if I be a man of God, then let fire come down from heaven then and consume thee and thy 50. Elijah now did not shake, he did not tremble. And this was a captain and 50 to arrest him, to take him. That the king, this one is not Jezebel, this one is not a woman, this one is a king that has authority. But thank God, when the power comes back, it doesn't matter the name of your persecutor, you will overcome in Jesus' name. You'll be more than a conqueror in Jesus' name. And then when he said the fire will come, and there came fire from where? From heaven, and consumed him and his 50. And again also he sent him another captain with 50, and he answered and said, O man of God, thus says the king, come down quickly. And Elijah answered and said, tell me, if I be a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume thee and thy 50. And the fire of God came down from heaven and consumed him and his 50. Where was this power when Elijah was running away? The power was there, but dormant. When you are running away, when you are discouraged, the power is there, but will be dormant. The power to heal the sick, it's there, it will be dormant. And the power to win souls to Christ, it will be there, it will be dormant. The power that will bring fire down, and all the demons will be burnt up from the lives of the people, the fire will be there, but everything will be dormant. When you are afraid, there will be no fear again. No discouragement again, and there's no fainting again. And he sent again in verse 13, again a captain of the third 50 with his 50. And the third captain of the 50 went up and came and fell on his feet before Elijah, and besought him and said unto him, O man of God, I pray thee, let my life and the life of the 50 of thy servant be precious in thy sight. This one was reasonable. A reasonable enemy. This one said, Elijah, I cannot touch you. I cannot tell you. The king said, I know what happened to the other people. They thought they could hurt you. I cannot hurt you. I cannot touch you. Have mercy on me. The king did not send him to go and plead, but the man was reasonable. When our enemies are reasonable, God will preserve them.
Amen.
When our persecutors are reasonable, the Lord will preserve them.
Amen.
And then they will even help you in the work God has committed your hand to do. Look at this, verse 14, behold, there came fire down from heaven and burnt up the two captains of the former 50s with their 50s. Therefore, let my life now be precious in the sight. And the angel of the Lord said unto Elijah, go down with him, be not afraid of him. And he arose and he went down with him unto the king. And he said unto the king, thus says the Lord. You know, the king now forgot that he wanted to kind of, oppress him or persecute him or even kill him if possible. But now, when your ways are pleasing to the Lord, your enemies will bow in Jesus' name. All the threats and everything they wanted to do before, they will not be able to do in Jesus' name. And then it says, for as much as thou hast sent your messengers to inquire of Beelzebub, the king of Ekron, is it not because there is no God in Israel to inquire of his word? Therefore, thou shalt not come down or from the bed on which thou hast gone up, but shall, give me the first sentence in verse 17. And so he died according to the word of the Lord, which he had spoken. Chapter 2. Look at chapter 2 now. His time had come to go home in the rapture. He wasn't to die. Something glorious is coming your way. Something extraordinary is coming your way. It's not the way you thought you'll go that you'll go. You'll go back, you'll go home triumphantly. You'll go back home faithfully. And you'll go with the chariots of heaven carrying you to heaven in Jesus' name. I'm looking at chapter 2 verse 8. Chapter 2 verse 8. And Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither, so that they too went over on dry ground. There's still a miracle for you to perform. There's still a ministry for you to perform. And there's still something extraordinary for you to accomplish. You'll accomplish it in Jesus' name. Verse 11, and it came to pass. It will come to pass. I'm looking at a life there. I said it will come to pass. I'm looking at a minister there. I said it will come to pass. I'm looking at something new coming your way. It will come to pass. And it came to pass as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire. A chariot of fire. You see, this man, a prophet of fire, he was not, to end his life with lukewarmness. He was not to end his life with despair. He was not to end his life with, I cannot, I will not, what can I do, with discouragement. He was to end in power. End in fire. End by chariot taking him to heaven. You are going to end triumphantly.
Yeah.
And all the discouragement of the past, everything will be gone in Jesus' name. It came to pass as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah, tell me out loud. You're going up. Somebody there, you're going up. Somebody there, I said, you're going up. Everything that tied you down will be broken. Every load of person to be down there will be broken. Discouragement is gone. All that crying is gone. All the self-pity is gone. And they went up by wild wind into heaven. Citizens of heaven, where are you? Candidates of heaven, where are you? When the time comes, you'll go home gloriously. Rise up and tell the Lord, rise up and tell the Lord. He regained everything. He regained the fire. He regained the faith. He regained the commitment. He regained the consecration. He regained the evidence of getting to heaven. And as he recovered strength and vision and passion, you're going to recover. He recovered conviction, courage and consecration. You're going to recover. He recovered faithfulness and fearlessness and fruitfulness. You're going to recover. Return, return, return and repair the altar. Renew your vow. Refocus your ministry and say, Lord, no more discouragement. No more fainting. I'm going up. I'm going up. And the Lord will confirm his word in your life.